Channel, as you can tell by the title, this is going to be a story time. Sorry if the lighting is a little off. I'm sitting in a dining room on the floor. This is going to be a story time about how I became a stripper. It's a little weird for me to even talk about this on this channel because many of you did not know that until like my last video or like one of my last videos. So yeah, I started dancing when I was like 22, 6 years ago. Started dancing when I was 22. It was definitely a whole nother world for me. I had met dancers before, and you know, I just never thought it would be me. I dated a guy when I was 19, and his sister was a dancer. And you know, she used to kid around and be like, you know, you need to come up to my job. And be like, girl, I'ma do it, you know, just joking around. Cause you know, that bitch needed some money, but I never thought that would be the route that I would take, you know? So, but look at me now. I didn't do it back when I was 19, you know, just out of fear. You know, you think about what other people gonna think about you, you know, can I really do it? Do I really have the confidence to do it? Because strippers have to have a certain type of confidence. Like if you're not confident, you're not gonna make no money. So, you know, I questioned myself about that. Like, I know I'm cute, you know. I know I can dance, but am I ready for that? Because that's a whole nother ballgame. Yeah, fast forward years later, me and the father of my oldest three kids were on, when I say really bad terms, I mean we was on really, really bad terms. We were going at it all the time. We weren't in a relationship. But I was staying in the house with like his dad and his grandmother. And they were, you know, they were cool people. They weren't pressuring me to get out, you know, or anything like that. You know, they were like, you know, you're more than welcome to stay. You know, you got our grandkids and everything. But as a woman, that just was not a position that I wanted to be in. Like, I'm not even staying with my family. I'm staying with my kids' father family. So I was like, you know, I'm ready to get out of that situation. I was working at Checkers, I think, when I first started. No, I was not. I was working at the Varsity. I'm not sure if you're from Atlanta or if you've been to Atlanta, but here we have this this spot called the Varsity, where, you know, they sell like chili dogs and stuff like that, but it's like this real big, you know, was real big hot spot here in Atlanta. So I was working there. I was making minimum wage. I think I was making minimum wage no more than $8. Here in Georgia, minimum wage is $7.25. So I wasn't making no more than $8 an hour. I was working night shift. I was working from 4 to 12 or 5 to 1. Your checks were not consistent. Because at this particular place, there are 28 registers. And so each register has a person there. Some registers have a runner, some don't. But depending on what number you were in line dictated how early you went home. So if you were like number 28, 27, anything from like 19 on down the line, you were going home early, like 10 o'clock, 9 o'clock. Like, if it slowed down, you were getting sent home. And in a way, you know, when you working in a place like that, it's cool to get sent home early until you get your check. So So to a certain extent, you know, you kind of try to make yourself go home early. Like, I want to be on the register down here because I don't feel like being here all day. And that was cool until you got paid. And we got paid every week. So your check be like one something, maybe two something. And I had three kids already. So that little money wasn't going to help me get out of no situation that I was in. It wasn't going to help me get into no apartment. It wasn't about to help me do none of that. So I hit up this girl that my she's gonna get crazy. I hit up this girl that my baby daddy used to talk to or whatever, who we went to school with. And you know, I hit her up and I was like, hey, I'm ready to start making some money. So she was like, all right, cool, you know. And at the time, she wasn't working at a club. You know, she was doing like bachelor parties and birthday parties and stuff like that. She had a team of girls or whatever. You know, all of them would do parties and stuff like that together. So I hit her up. She was like, you, all right, you know, cool. I got a party for us to do or whatever. And I ended up flaking out. I got scared. I didn't do it. And I didn't hit her back up until maybe like a month later when money got real tight. Like, my pockets were so tight, I was suffocating. You know what I mean? So money got really, really tight. I felt like my situation was getting a little worse. Me and him, you know, were getting worse. Everything was just getting worse. So I hit her up again and I was like, you know, I'm ready. Like, I'm not bullshitting you. Like, I'm ready. Because she's one of them girls, like, she been in the game for so long, like, she about her money and she ain't got time for no bullshit. So, you know, she was like, are you know, you sure this time? I'm gonna put you on the list and da da da. You know, you gonna be there, you know, send me your pictures and this, that, and the third. So I'm like, yeah, man, you know, I'm gonna do it. So I was like, you know, but I don't know what to wear, I don't know none of that. So I end up going to City Trends. City Trends is like a little clothing store here. I don't know if they're worldwide or whatever the case may be, but we got a store here in Georgia called City Trends. I end up going to City Trends and getting me like two little lingerie outfits and some heels. Looking back at it, like, what the fuck? Like, you dancing in lingerie, bitch. Get your life. But that's all I had. Like, it was one of them started from the bottom type situations. I took my last check that I had and went and got that stuff. Because I was like, you know, if I'm going to do this, I know I'm going to make the money back. I was really just being hopeful, you know, that I'm going to make my money back. So I went to City Trends and I bought that stuff and I went to the party. I went. And I was scared and I was like Diamond from Players Club, that was me, like, what the fuck am I doing here? But just like Diamond, your girl got tipsy. It was this one girl who was there and it was a mansion party. So like, these people had rented out like this big ass mansion here in Atlanta. And at the mansion party, like, there were a lot of strippers there. There was maybe 20 plus of us. And the house was packed. Like, it was like well over 150 people. And after a couple of drinks, I wasn't scared no more. Like, when that money started coming in, I was not scared. Like, it was time for me to do what I had to do. And once that money started coming in, you kind of forget your fear. Once that liquor started kicking in, you really start to forget your fear. So, and by the end of the night, I had made a few hundred. Like, I remember making like $500 and something that night. And that was my first experience. And I was like, holy shit. Bitch, when is the next party? Book me. I am there. And me and her, you know, even though she used to date my kid's father, like, our relationship between me and her, it took off because she realized, like, you a hustler. Like, you want to meet, like, your first night, this what you capping out on, you know what I'm saying? Like, you really about your money. And it didn't bother me that she used to date him or was dating him or whatever they had going on, because we weren't together no more. I was at a point where I didn't even look at him like that no more. Like, nigga, please. You know what I'm saying? Like, that's where I was at with it. Long story short, you know, she ended up cutting him off. Anyway, that's a whole other story. We ain't even gonna get into that. But me and her rocked strong. Like, we rocked really, really strong. And I did a lot of parties after that. Like, I did a lot of parties after that. And everything was good. Like, I told Corey, my baby daddy, you know, I had let his people know. I was like, you know, I'm working. But, you know, I told him, like, I was working at a warehouse or some stupid shit like that. Like, overnight, third shift type of situation. Which they probably went stupid because I was going to work with inches in my head, eyelashes on. Stuff you wouldn't normally go to work with if you working at a warehouse. And then I quit that job. I quit the varsity after, like, my third party because I was like, I'm making like $100 and something here a week. Yet I'm doing parties and cashing out at like $5 something a party, $6 something a party. Like, I'm done. Like, I didn't get them no 2 weeks notice, no nothing. I just went in there to get my last check and was out the door. And they was like, you know, how come you ain't been to work? And I was like, I found another job. Like, I'm not doing this no more. Plus, my manager was a pervert. Like, he was a pervert. Like, y'all, anyway, that's a whole nother story too. So I was done working at that spot. And then I started working at Checkers. I don't know why, like, I've always been a hustler. I've always been about my money. So even though I was dancing, I still felt the need to have, like, another check coming in because I'm dancing at night and I can be working here, you know, when I'm not doing the parties, and the parties are at night, so I can get another job. That was my mindset, you know, just to maximize my earnings. So I started working at Checkers, and in the midst of me working at Checkers, I met a dude named Sherrod. So I started dating this dude named Rod or whatever, and he was telling me, like, I remember his mama them coming to pick me up from my house one day, and I was going to spend the night at their house. And so while we in the car, his mama was like, you know, hey, how you doing? You know, just like trying to get to know me, trying to feel me out. And, you know, she was like, you know, what do? Do you work? And so Rod, big mouth ass, was like, she a stripper, mom. And I was just like my heart fell in my ass. Like, you did not just tell your mama this. Like, you know, that's not something that dudes tell their mama. Like, I was ready to lie. I was ready to make up a whole lie about what I did. And you just done let the damn cat out the bag. And so his sister, who I had never even met his sister. And so she was listening to her headphones, and I guess she, you know, kind of overheard it. And so she was like, for real, me too. So his mama was like, they ain't nothing to be ashamed of. And this is one of my homegirls to this day. Her name is Kitty. She was like, mama called her Isha. She was like, Isha shake her ass too. It ain't nothing to be ashamed of, girl. You know, you gotta get your money. So, you know, after that, everything was cool. But it was just crazy that, you know, he outed me like that. And so his sister was like, you know, you should come to the club where I work at or whatever. It's a conversation we just having in the car. Like, it's a normal conversation. But she like, you know, you should come to the club that I'm working at or whatever. So Rod was like, don't be taking her to that bullshit ass club. She ain't gonna make no money there. They don't make no money there. So I wanted to try for myself. So, you know, I told her, I was like, you know, the next time I come down here and spend the night or whatever, I'll do it. So the next time I went and spent the night down their house, I went and I made money. When I tell you I went to this club and made money, I go back to the house and I'm like, nigga, don't you ever tell your sister don't take me somewhere because I made some money. I don't know what, what you talking about. I made some money. And that ended up being my home club for like 2 years. Yep. That was my first club that I had ever worked in. And that club showed me so much love. I grew at that club. And when I say I grew at that club, like when I first started working there, I didn't know, other than like me dancing at bachelor parties and stuff like that, I had never been in the strip club, you know, atmosphere. So I really learned how to hustle at a club, because hustling at a club versus hustling at parties is completely different. You doing a party, you might got like 10 girls, you know, that's your competition. Granted, you know, some of these are your friends and stuff like that, but I still mean competition as in where your money is coming from. When you go to a club, you got 50 to 100 bitches and the club is full of men. And so it's you competing against 50 to 100 bitches. Like the ratio is completely different. So you got to step your hustling game up a lot. That's when I started kind of getting into like makeup and everything like that. Like really got into weave and doing my hair. And like I said, I just really, really learned a lot at that club. I appreciate that experience so much. Like, I do. That helped me through a lot. I didn't have to depend on nobody. I was able to take care of myself and not have to be aggravated with my baby daddy if he couldn't supply what my kids needed. It was to a point where it was like, if you do for them, you do for them. If you don't, when you're struggling, we good. You know, and I really enjoyed that part in my life. I really grew from there. And then I started, then I stopped dancing because I got engaged. And that's when I got engaged to Sean. And so, you know, of course, as a dude, he's one of those dudes who's like, you know, I don't want my wife stripping or whatever, or my girlfriend or none of that. Like, I don't want to marry a stripper. So I definitely respected that. And so I stopped. I found a regular job. That's when I was working at the daycare. Worked at the daycare for a while. Money got tight. Before I even got pregnant with Ashley, you know, reality hit and money started to get tight. And so I jumped back into dancing and I started doing the parties and everything like that. And then I got pregnant with Ashley and then I stopped. And I started back after I had Ashley. Because once again, now I've been on maternity leave. Sean has had to carry the family on his back by himself. And we weren't necessarily in a hole, but our head was like just above water, if you know what I mean, so to speak. So I felt like that's my hustle. Like that's how I know how to go get money instantly. So I ended up calling my dad, and you know, and I was like, Daddy, I need $325, or I need $300, or whatever the case may be, because that's how much it is to get your license here in Georgia to dance. You have to have a license, and here it is $315 or $325 or something like that. So I called my dad, and you know, I was like, can I have $300? And he was like, yeah, come and get it. I went and got that money the same day. I went down to that club, got hired, went and got my permit, like all of this in the same day, and started working that next day. Like, I was not playing. I was about my coins, and I made it work. So I started back, and that was my full-time job. Like, I stopped working all these other jobs, and I was just grinding. And this particular club that I got hired at, I am still at to this day. I'm looking at going to other clubs. Maybe, I'm not sure, because every club is different. So you just never know how, you know, things are gonna turn out. But I'm still at that club, and I mean, that's pretty much it. Like, and I've been doing it now for 6 years. God willing, I'll be done by the time I'm 30, no later than 32. If I can be done by the time I'm 32, if my business jumps off the ground and does really good, I'm gonna be done. I'll be done. That's what I'm hoping for. And I know, you know, it's gonna be a lot of people who gonna watch this and be like, 30, 32, like, that's too old, or whatever the case may be. But it's easy to say when you're not in that situation, because I'm 28 now. So it's real easy to say when you're not in that situation how you will go about things. But the money is so good, and you tend to get caught up in the money. A stripper is equivalent to a dope boy. When you try to make a dope boy leave the dope game alone and go get a regular job, that money ain't the same. That freedom is not the same. None of it is the same. And it's hard. It's hard to rewire your brain to be just the average Joe, so to speak. And that's the same way it is with us. That's why a lot of dancers don't go to a regular job. They start their own businesses, or they get stuck in the game. Because I know women who are practically 50, 50, and still dance. 50. I see them every day. 40s. Every day. Because they didn't have a way out. So it's hard. Lucky enough, I'm smart enough to try to plan my way out. And I hope to God it worked. I'm not even gonna say I hope to God it worked. I know it's gonna work, because that's how determined and motivated I am. So hopefully I'll be done within the next 2 to 4 years. But I got food in the oven. I got a roast in the oven, and I have to get ready to start on my cabbages. So I'm gonna have to let this video go right here. If you guys have any questions, comments, all that good stuff, leave it below. Follow me on social media. My IG is the number one fine dynasty. Yeah. And I'm gonna let you guys go so I can go cook this food. Go back real quick. So I can go cook this food. So don't forget to like, thumbs up, comment, subscribe. If you're new here, please subscribe. I am trying to reach 400 by August 1st. Trying to reach 400 by August 1st. So go ahead and hit that subscribe button. I really, really appreciate you guys. Love y'all. See y'all later.